Hare Krishna, welcome to all to our Bhakti Vaibhav class. So in the last couple of weeks, we were discussing from third canto, wherein Diti, approaching her husband Kashyapa at a wrong time, became the cause of the progeny of two sons, who will be the cause of tormentation for the entire universe. But understanding this, that they are going to cause trouble to the entire universe, Diti held the embryo within a womb for 100 years, 100 long years. But at the womb, as the embryo is growing, they caused disturbance in the entire universe by creating darkness all around. So unable to tolerate the darkness, all the devatas approached Lord Brahma, requesting the cause, of course, requesting the remedy for the disturbance. So that time Lord Brahma taking the opportunity, he describes, he briefly explains the reason for the current situation, that previously his four Kumaras, his four mind-born sons, traveling all over the universe, they have entered into Vaikuntha with a desire to have darshan of the Supreme Lord. As they passed through the six gates, at the entry of the seventh gate, the gatekeepers, Jaya, Vijaya, seeing these four boys who are wearing no clothes, who are wearing all the four directions at their clothes, and without being informing, they are trying to enter into the seventh gate. Then Jaya and Vijaya kind of stopped the four Kumaras, asking for their identity. Who are you? Why are you entering? Where are you going? Etc. The four Kumaras, just like any small boys, though they were very old as Lord Brahma, but they appeared like 5 years boys, small children. That's why they are called as Kumara. The Kaumara is the age generally between 0 to 5. So that's why they are called Kumaras. So just like if any small children in your respective homes, you must have seen, we see in our homes that small children, if they are stopped from doing something, they begin to cry. They become angry, pull legs here and there, and kick with the legs and hit with the hands and cry, shout, and so many things they do. Similarly, here the four Kumaras who are like small boys who are not stopped anywhere, since they are stopped by Jaya Vijaya from entering into Vaikuntha, they became angry. And they are not too small to cry, because, I mean, they are as old as Lord Brahma. So they uttered a small curse on Jaya and Vijaya. So saying a few words that Lord Vishnu is the source of everything and the source of other also. What fear do you have upon Lord Vishnu that somebody will come and harm Lord Vishnu within Vaikuntha? So Lord Vishnu never minds. He has never restrictions on Brahmanas. And how could you, two gatekeepers, behave against to the will of the Supreme Lord? It is not fitting for you to be in Vaikuntha. So better you people go to a place where lust, anger, greed are prominent. Like that, they said. As soon as the Jaya Vijaya heard these words of the Brahmanas, they fell at the feet of the Brahmanas, for the four Kumaras, and begged forgiveness immediately. Please forgive us for our impudence. So, on the spur of a moment, we just uttered the words, who are you, why are you entering, please forgive us, like that. And immediately, on the other hand, the four Kumaras also kind of felt ashamed that they have unnecessarily, for no reason, have uttered a big curse on Jaya and Vijaya. So like that, both the parties kind of thinking that they have unnecessarily acted in a over way upon the other party. The Jaya Vijaya for no reason acted upon Kumaras, and Kumaras for no reason cursed upon Jaya Vijaya. So both were feeling remorse. So the feeling of remorse from both the parties have attracted the Supreme Lord. Then immediately, the Supreme Lord, who was there inside his own palace, which is just after the seventh entry, he immediately came there along with Mother Lakshmi with some intention. He had so many intentions with his mind in relation to the four Kumaras and also in relation to Jaya Vijaya, which we will come to know by the end of the next chapter. Why he brought Mother Lakshmi, why he came immediately to that place. But in a way, to pacify both of them, and also to do the needful, what he is expecting from both of them, etc., etc. So that was the place where we have kind of stopped. And now we will see how the Supreme Lord is coming to the seventh gate. having understood that both of them are kind of disturbed each other, and both of them are became remorseful and begging forgiveness from each other. So now let us start from verse number 37 onwards, wherein 37 talks about Lord's coming to the gate, and 38 to 42 talks about the beauty of the Supreme Lord experienced by the four Kumaras. So till now they have heard about the form of the Supreme Lord. Sorry, they were experiencing Brahmananda, but now, at least apparently from this chapter, we can understand that they are experiencing the beauty of the Supreme Lord for the first time. Seems to be like that. Evam tadaiva bhagavan aravindanabha swanam vibhudya sadatikrama marya hrudya tasmin yahau paramahamsa mahamuninam anveshaniya charanau chalayan sahasri.
At that very moment, the Lord, who is called Padmanabha because of the lotus grown from his navel, and who is the delight of the righteous, learned about the insult offered by his own servants to the saints. Accompanied by his spouse, the goddess of fortune, he went to the spot on those very feet sought by recluses and great sages.
Yeah, so many things are mentioned. It seems that the Supreme Lord came to the seventh gate on foot, walking on foot. He did not come flying, or he did not come on a palanquin or a chariot. He came by walking. So that shows that the Lord is so eager to come to his devotees. So the both parties feeling remorseful upon another party that they unnecessarily reacted in a over way with the other party, that attracted the Supreme Lord. The Supreme Lord came along with Mother Lakshmi, Sahasri. So why they came along with Mother Lakshmi? There is one point mentioned by Acharya Srila Prabhupada. They say that the four Kumaras have heard about the Supreme Lord as the Parabrahman for many, 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 many times. And they have also heard about various energies of the Supreme Lord. So what was that? There was one verse. Natasya karyam karanam cha vidyate the Lord will have unlimited energies at his disposal. So many energies. Jnana, Balak, Kriyacha, etc. etc. So the Lord wants to show to the Kumaras that who is the source of all those energies. Though there are so many energies in this world, everyone is familiar with all those different energies, but who is the source of all those energies? The source of all those energies is Chit Shakti, internal potency. That internal potency is Mother Lakshmi. She is personally staying here in Vaikuntha. So in order to display the source of all his energies to the four Kumaras, who are kind of followers of Brahman, the Supreme Lord brought Mother Lakshmi along with him. So that was the intention with which they came here. Anvesha Niya Charanau Chalayam. And why he came on walking on lotus feet? One more point is that Anveshaniya Charanav. That Mahamuninam, Paramahamsa Mahamuninam, all the great Paramahamsas and Mahamunis like four Kumaras who are Jnanis and Yogis, great, great personalities, they sought after the lotus feet of Lord Vishnu. So that lotus feet which is sought after by all these great Yogis is coming by walking on foot to the devotees. So that lotus feet which is hankered after by the great yogis and jnanis is in the service of the devotees. So that is another point. Like that, it is being indicated here. So the Supreme Lord comes on foot to the seventh gate. Then, now from verse number 38 all the way up to 42, the Kumaras are going to experience the wonderful, beautiful form of the Supreme Lord. So here we can understand from these 4-5 verses that when we happen to come in front of the deities, we should start seeing from the lotus feet, all the way up to the lotus face. So all these verses will describe in the same manner. If you clearly observe, you will understand. त्वन्त्वागतं प्रतिहृता प्रतिहृतौ पैकं स पुम्बेस्ताक्ष विषयं स्वसमाधि भाग्यम् हंसश्रियोर्वजनयोर्शिववायुलोलात् शुभ्रातपत्र शशिकेशरश शीकराम शीकराम्बुम्।
The sages headed by Sanak Rishi saw the supreme personality of Godhead Vishnu, who was formerly visible only within their hearts in ecstatic trance, had now actually become visible to their eyes. As he came forward, accompanied by his own associates bearing all paraphernalia such as an umbrella and an charmer fan, the wide bunches of hair moved very gently like two swans, and due to their favorable breeze and pearls garlanding the umbrella also moved like drops of nectar falling from the white full moon or ice melting due to gust of wind.
Yeah, a nice analogy is explained in this verse. We will discuss that, but before that, tamtva agatam pratihruta प्रतिहृतौ पैकं स्वपुंबि ते अचक्ष ताक्ष विषयं स्वसमाधि भाग्यम्। सो स्वसमाधि भाग्यम मीन द ग्रेट योगीस और ज्ञानीस पर्सनालिटीज लाइक फोर कुमारास दे ट्राई टू एक्सपीरियंस द सुप्रीम लॉर्ड जनरली ओनली इन देयर विद इन देयर मेडिटेशन। द योगीस व्हेन दे परफॉर्म अष्टांग योगा एज वी डिस्कस इन द सेकंड कैंटो फर्स्ट चैप्टर एंड सेकंड चैप्टर ड्यूरिंग द स्टेज ऑफ धारणा ध्यान समाधि दे एक्चुअली meditated upon the Paramatma form of the Supreme Lord within their heart. So that was to maximum extent they can approach the Supreme Lord. But such kind of yogis now have the good fortune of Bhagyam, good fortune of Achakshata Aksha Vishayam. Aksha Vishayam. The form which is the object for the eyes, which the yogis our jnanis like kumaras are always meditating upon within their heart, has become a reality within their eye, in front of their eyes now, which about whom they were meditating upon till now, about whom they were heard from their father Lord Brahma, now they had the good fortune of having the darshan of the Supreme Lord now in front of their eyes. So that is being indicated here in this verse, and that's why Prabhupada actually takes this verse that अजक्षताक्ष विषयम् समाधि भाग्यम्। He explained this two words in the purport very nicely. हंस श्रियोर व्यजनयो शिव वायु लोलक। So here there is wonderful. What kind of darshan the four kumaras had when the Lord came? हंस श्रियोर व्यजनयोर। So on two sides of the Supreme Lord there are two great personalities doing chamar seva. So he is actually vyajana, vyajana your chamara, vyajana. Vyajana is this one, fly with the peacock feathers. So that we say. So amsas shriyor. It indicates that on both the sides, the two people are doing vyajana seva, fanning actually. So actually it is more than vajra and more than peacock feather, it should be chamara, because both of them are looking like hamsa shriyor, the beautiful swans. They are moving on either side of Lord Vishnu, appears to be like two swans are flapping around standing next to the Supreme Lord like that. And shiva vayu lolak subrata patra shishikeshara shikarambu. And on top of the Supreme Lord there is a nice white umbrella which is like the moon, and that umbrella had so many ropes hanging down tied with so many birds pulls. So all of them appears to be like the umbrella like the moon, and all these things appears to be like the nectar drops falling from the moon. And that entire area is filled with the fragrant aroma. Shashi Keshara Shikara Ambu and Shiva Vayu. Shiva Vayu is very nice, fragrant, auspicious, fragrant breeze are coming around. And the umbrella is like the moon. And from that umbrella, the pulse are hanging down, tied to a small, small threads. And that entire thing appears to be like the nectar drops are falling from the moon. So like that, that kind of darshan. Basically, the accessories are being described in this verse. The two chamara vajanas, whatever we can say, they are apparently like beautiful sands, and the umbrella like the moon, and the bird, pulse birds are like, the pulse are like water droplets falling from the moon, like that. But another way to express this is that the entire, what was this? Umbrella, it is like inverted lotus flower, an inverted lotus flower. The petals are like the inner filaments of the lotus flower, which are coming down from the middle. And then the lotus flower is emitting nice fragrance, Shiva Vayu. And also the lotus flower is very tender to touch. So basically Lord Darshan is giving a beautiful experience of all the senses to look at, to touch, to smell, and to hear. All those things we will also get to hear in the future verses. So the Kumaras are having the experience of Lord Darshan through all the five senses. And eventually it goes all the way up to the mind in the 43rd verse. So like that, it is indicated. So all the accessories with which the Supreme Lord came there, surrounded by all his internal associates, it is being indicated in this verse. Krishna prasada sumukam spruhani yadama seva sneha valoka kalaya hrudi samprashantam shame prutau purasi shobitaya shriyasvas chudamanim subhagayantamivatma dishnim.
The Lord is the reservoir of all pleasure. His auspicious presence is meant for everyone's benediction, and his affectionate smiling and glancing touch the core of the heart. The Lord's beautiful bodily color is blackish, and his broad chest is the resting place of the goddess of fortune, who glorifies the entire spiritual world, the summit of all heavenly planets. Thus it appeared that the Lord was personally spreading the beauty and good fortune of the spiritual world.
So here, the Lord's demeanor is being described. How the Lord is expressing his satisfaction with the arrival of the four Kumaras, that is indicated here in this verse. Krishna Prasada, that means Lord completely satisfied. Sumukam is favorably inclined. Spruhaniya Dama. So Spruhaniya Dama means is the object of one's desire. Spruhaniya. Spruha means one is always conscious. Dhamma is the ultimate abode. The Maddhamma, Paramamma, like that Bhagavad Gita talks about Lord's Dhamma many times. Dhamma indicates the abode of the Supreme Lord. Dhamma also indicates the form of the Supreme Lord in that way. Snehava Loka Kalaya. The way Lord is glancing upon the four Kumaras is filled with sneha, affection and friendship. Hrudi Samprashantam, and is completely satisfied. Lord is not agitated. Though the Kumaras and the Jayavijaya were agitated here because the things that happened like that, but the Lord is very peaceful. Shame Prutav Urasi Shobitaya Shriyaswas Chudamanim Sabhusavayantam Ivatma Dishnam. And the Lord was beautifully decorated with all the wonderful ornaments, etc. And the Supreme Lord himself is one of the best of all ornaments in comparison to all other personalities, in comparison to all other abodes. So like that, Iva Atma Dishnam. So he is like the Lord of everyone. So in that way. So he is the object of love. So here Lord's beauty in a way is indicated. And Shriyaswas Chudamani. It is also indicated that the goddess of fortune, he is being seated on the chest of Lord Vishnu accompanied by Chudamani. So basically on the neck Lord wears Chudamani, the Kaustubha jewel, etc. And on the right side of on his chest there is the mark of Mother Lakshmi, Sri Vasta. So like that, that is indicated. So basically here this is wonderful word. Krishna Prasada Sumukam. The Supreme Lord is always pleasingly disposed with respect to his devotees. So Lord becomes very much pleased to see his devotees. Very much pleased to have the association of his devotees. So that is being indicated in this purport. Prabhupada explains about it. The Lord being equal to all is always eager to bless his devotees. Looking mercifully towards them, is always ready to bestow his mercy upon his devotees. So Prabhupada further talks about Spruhaniya Dhamma, indicate that the Lord is the reservoir of all pleasure because he has all the transcendental qualities. He is the reservoir of all pleasure, that is one meaning. The other meaning is, he is the object of one's worship. If you take Dhamma as the person, then is Spruhaniya Dhamma. So a person is always the constant remembrance or constant meditation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So like that.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji.
Prabhuji, what exactly is Srivatsa Chinna? Like where Mother Lakshmi keeps her head, there is some indentation, or I have read somewhere that it is like golden hair or something. What exactly is Srivatsa Chinna?
So my understanding is that generally, I mean, this is what I heard from Sri Vaishnava, visiting Sri Vaishnava temples. Wherever we see the Lord Vishnu's temples, many times Lord Vishnu is alone there. In our ISKCON temples, we always see that Radha Krishna is always together. We don't see them single. So Lord Vishnu is alone. Somebody might question, how can Lord Vishnu be alone? There is always, you see any Vishnu temple, in the main temple, there is Vishnu's deity will be there. Side by little away, there will be Lakshmi's temple. Lakshmi Devi's temple will be separate. But the internal understanding is Mother Lakshmi, though she stays little far from the Lord, but she always resides in the chest of the Supreme Lord. So that is called Srivasta Mark. Srivasta Mark, sometimes in the Sri Vaishnava temple, they keep a locket with Mother Lakshmi being placed on the chest of the Supreme Lord. Or otherwise, they say that there is a white hair or golden hair which is there on the chest of the Supreme Lord. The left side of the chest of the Supreme Lord, the position of the heart. So it is like that. So that is my understanding about Srivasa.
Okay, thank you, Prabhu.
Pitam shuke brutunitam bane vispurantya kancha libir virutaya vanamalaya cha वल्गु प्रकोष्ठवलयं विनता सुतांसे विन्यस्तहस्तमितरेण दुनानं भजम् अब्जम् दुनानाम् अब्जम्
He was adorned with a girdle that shone brightly on the yellow cloth, covering his large hips, and he wore a garland of fresh flowers, which was distinguished by humming bees. His lovely wrists were graced with bracelets, and he rested one of his hands on the shoulder of Garuda, his carrier, and trailed a lotus with another hand.
So here, the Lord's form is being described. The first verse talked about Lord coming to this place on his foot. So the Lord's feet was described there, which is the object of worship for all the object of meditation for all the jnanis and yogis. Now in this verse, his other bodily limbs are mentioned. Pitam shuke prutunitambini vispru vispurantya. So Lord is wearing the beautiful pitambar clothes, yellow garments, the golden yellow garments. And top of that on the waist, he is also wearing a beautiful belt. Kancha libir virutaya vanamala yacha. And then above the belt, on his chest, He was wearing a wonderful vanamala, which is surrounded by alibir. Alibir refers to bumblebees. So many bumblebees are surrounding that vanamala, the flower forest garland, garland made up of forest flowers. Valgu prakosta valayam vinata sutamshe. So then he says that valgu prakosta valayam vinata sutamshe, that indicates that his hands or wrists are decorated by the bracelets. The waist portion is indicated, the chest portion decorated by garlands, and the wrist hands are decorated by so many wonderful beautiful bracelet. And then vinyasya hastam itarena, vinyasya hastam, it says that vinana vinata sutamshe vinasa vinata suta. Vinata suta is referring to Garuda. So Kashyapa Muni had many wives. Among them, one wife is Vinata, and son of the Vinata is Garuda. So on Garuda, Garuda is also accompanying Lord Vishnu. He kept one hand on top of Garuda. One hand is there, out of four hands, one hand is there on the Gatna, on the shoulder of Garuda. Itarena, with the other hand, Dunanam Abjam. Abjam is Kamal Abjam, one lotus flower. Dunanam means, from our Hindi, we say Dona. Dona means? No, one is wash. How do you wash? What is the procedure of washing? Well, the Muda cloth of two and fro. So with the other hand, the Supreme Lord holding a lotus flower within his hand, he is moving the stem of the lotus flower to and fro, front and back, front and back, front and back. So like that. That's why itarena dunanam abjam. With the other hand, just like we wash clothes, moving them front and back, making like in a round wall like that. So that's what Lord is doing. And one may ask question, why Lord is doing like this? He could stand peacefully, can stand stable. So why he is doing like this? So having displayed his beautiful form to the four Kumaras, who are Jnanis and Yogis, who are always meditating on Brahman, who are experiencing Brahmananda continuously from the time of their birth. So he wanted to test their meditation on Brahman, whether their meditation on Brahman is still remaining, or is there some disturbance. So basically, by moving the lotus flower, the stem of the lotus flower to and fro, aage piche, Lord is churning their heart. Just like in a part of yogurt, when the mother want to churn, there is a churning rod with a thread. So the right hand goes front and left hand goes back, and the left hand goes front, right hand goes like that, aage piche hota hai. So that is called churning. Same way here, the Lord is churning the heart of the four Kumaras. And let us see whether something happens by that churning. So Lord basically want to test whether are you still remain loyal to your Brahman or Brahmananda, or you are going to change and transform. So that is the intention with which the Supreme Lord is doing this thing. विद्युत क्षिपन मकर कुंडल मंडनार्हा गंधस्थलोन्न समुखं मणिमत् किरीटं दोर्दंड संध विवरे हरता परार्द्या हारेन कंदर गतेन च कौस्तुभेन. आपी पढ़ सकते थोड़ा लाउडली.
That enhanced the beauty of his alligator-shaped pendants, which outshone lightning. His nose was prominent, and his head was covered with a gem-studded crown. A charming necklace hung between his stout arms, and his neck was adorned with the gem known by the name Kaustubha.
So, having described his lotus feet, and his thighs covered by Pitambara cloth, and the waist is covered by the belt, and the neck is covered, the chest portion is covered by vanamala, surrounded by bumblebees, and the wrist is covered by so many armlets, etc. And then two hands. One hand is kept on the shoulder of Garuda, one hand with one other hand is twirling the lotus flower, etc. And now the remaining portion of the Lord's form is described. His neck is further bedecked with Kaustubhajam. And there are so many hand necklaces hanging between the stout arms. And then his head is decorated with wonderful, beautiful crown, decorated with so many jewels. And his two ears are decorated with Makara Kundala, the Makara shaped earrings, etc. So this is the beauty of the Supreme Lord. It came all the way up to the face. And now the next verse goes further more details into the face, the beautiful face. The beauty of the face is further described. Atropasrishtamiti chosmitamindriyay indri indiraya swanam diya viratitam bahusaushtavadhyam mayam bhavasya bhavatam cha bhajanam bhajantamangam nemur nirikshana vitrupadrusho mudakai.
The executive beauty of Narayana, being many times magnified by the intelligence of his devotees, was so attractive that it defeated the pride of the goddess of fortune in being the most beautiful. My dear demigods, the Lord who thus manifested himself is worshipped by me, by Lord Shiva, and by all of you. The sages regarded him with unsated eyes and joyously bowed their heads at his lotus feet.
So further beauty of the Supreme Lord is described. Atra upasrishtam iti cha usmitam indiraya. So it says that Indira, Mother Lakshmi. Atra upasrishtam iti cha usmitam indiraya. Swanam diya virachitam bahu saushtavadyam. So Mother Lakshmi came along with Lord Vishnu. Both of them are standing together. So generally the beauty of female is glorified a lot in this world. So Mother Lakshmi also might be thinking that I am so beautiful and my Lord is next to me and he is also so beautiful. She might be thinking like that. But in order to give astonishment to Mother Lakshmi also, the Supreme Lord's beauty currently at this point of time increased million folds more than the beauty of Mother Lakshmi. So in that way, even though Mother Lakshmi would always think that she is the most beautiful, but now the beauty of the Supreme Lord increased more than that of Mother Lakshmi. So further he says that Swanam Diyar Virachitam Bahusaushta Vadyam. By engaging his own attendants, the Supreme Lord decorated himself much more beautiful than that of Mother Lakshmi. So just to attract the four Brahmanas, the four Kumaras who are attracted to Brahman, in order to mesmerize them, the Lord increased his beauty more than Mother Lakshmi. And Mayam Bhavasya Bhavatamcha Bhajantam Angam. The Lord's bodily limbs, Angam, the body for the Lord's form, is the object of worship of Mayam, mine, Lord Ramai saying, and Bhavasya of Lord Shiva, and Bhavatam of yours, O Devatas, Cha, and all others, everyone in this world. The beautiful form of the Supreme Lord is the object of worship for everyone, including myself, Lord Shiva, and yourself, and everyone, rest of the people in this entire world. Nemur nirikshana vitrutta drisho muda mudakai. It says that the four Kumaras, having witnessed the wonderful beauty of the Supreme Lord, having tasted it with all senses, with eyes they saw, with nose they smelled the fragrance of the Supreme Lord, with kind of tongue they tasted the beauty of the Supreme Lord, and with ears they could have heard some mantras chanted by all the associates of the Supreme Lord, etc. So whatever, like this, they have experienced the Supreme Lord through all the senses in that way. But having experienced all these things, so naturally being defeated, that okay, we thought that till now Brahmananda is the topmost thing, but the form of the Supreme Lord is much more than that. So they felt humiliated and they fell at the feet of the Supreme Lord. they were offering obeisances to the feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that is what is happening now.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji.
Prabhuji, here the line in the translation says that the exquisite beauty of Narayana being many times magnified by the intelligence of his devotees. What it means, Prabhuji, like means the description which devotee do with their intelligence about the Lord, is it that way we have to understand?
No. Here, the understanding is, today, Lord Vishnu gave special empowerment to his attendants who decorate the Lord every day. So they have become more intelligent and they have decorated Lord in such a way that his beauty is thousandfold increased than that of Mother Lakshmi. It's like that.
Okay. And there was one more query, Prabhuji, like in the last lecture, which I heard the recording, there also we discussed that initially, these poor Kumaras went to Vaikuntha as they were very eager to take darshan of the Lord.
Yes.
So we are saying that those are poor Kumaras were Brahmavadis and they were happy in Brahman realization. So why a Brahman realized person will be eager to take darshan of the Lord? Because they are not refusing the very concept that the Lord has a form and they are just...
No, please. I was discussing, sorry to say that, we were discussing from the very beginning, there are two categories of people, Brahmavadis and Mayavadis. Mayavadis reject the form of the Supreme Lord, not the Brahmavadis. Brahmavadis accept the form of the Supreme Lord, but they are the devotees of Brahman. They never deny the form of the Supreme Lord. They are the devotees of Brahman and hence they glorify Brahman as the best supreme. They have superlative degree of affinity towards Brahman. They are not Mayavadis. Four Kumaras are not Mayavadis. Kindly, please do not have that kind
and
of...
Then, opinion. Prabhuji, when somebody knows about the form of the Lord, how can one remain Brahmavadi? Like, means when they are knowing that Lord is having form and is a beautiful form, still, how can they have attachment for the Brahman? Like,
it could be, Mataji. They have heard about Brahman more from the very beginning. That's why...
Okay, maybe they have some vague understanding that Lord also has form, but they know more about the Brahman.
See, for example, I would say my example. I was born and brought up in Andhra Pradesh. Since childhood, I have heard a lot about Lord Venkatesha, Tirupati. So we naturally have affinity towards Lord Venkatesha. Whenever there is the opportunity, we want to go to Tirupati and have darshan and spend a day there and visit all the holy places nearby and come home. I never heard so much about Lord Krishna in my childhood, even though we have heard little bit, but because of that I did not have affinity to go to Madura, Vrindavan, have darshan of the Lord Krishna, etc. Because Lord Balaji was very near to us, we were hearing about him very often and we used to watch dramas and all played about him, etc. So we naturally developed affinity towards Lord Balaji, Lord Venkatesha. But of course, now after coming to ISKCON and all, we have developed affinity towards Krishna. That is a different thing. So this is my understanding. About whom? Of course, all of them are same personality, one personality. There is no difference between the three. But there are three different ways they are Lord manifests. But about whom a person hears from the very beginning, they naturally develop affinity for them. This is general understanding.
Okay. Thank you.
And if you remember, what was the discussion that we had during the 12th chapter? What was the service of the four Kumaras? Hare Krishna, Mataji, or anybody else?
I'm listening.
What was the service of the four Kumaras? What dharma? Today, Bhavatan class, suna lagta hai.
Glorifying the Lord, like they were not like Narada, but they were wandering here and there and preaching about the Lord and glorifying the Lord.
No, we discussed elaborately the service of the four Kumaras. For what purpose they appeared? Who are they? Huh? Loudly. Vinit Prabhu says that they appear to preach jnana, vairagya, tapasya and yoga. Jnana, yoga, vairagya, tapasya. All these are kind of teachings towards Brahman. They are naturally the teachers of jnana and yoga. So, acharati, apne acharati sabha shikayala Prabhu. So, they need to be affectionate towards Brahman so that they can teach about Brahman. Otherwise, they are devotees of something and they teach something else. How could it be possible? That doesn't mean that they are not devotees. They are devotees, but they are the teachers of jnana and yoga. So, they definitely have natural affection for jnana and yoga and their object of the goal of jnana and yoga. So, like that, we can see.
Okay.
Of course, we also have Kumara Sampradaya, where they purely teach bhakti to some who deserve the teachings of bhakti. So, in that way, we have to see.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhu.
So, where were we? The beauty of the Lord was so enchanting that it could not be sufficiently described. Of course, 4-5 verses only described, there is no end to describe the beauty of the Lord. But now, having witnessed the beauty of the Supreme Lord, now what kind of transformation took place in the heart of the four Kumaras? The 43rd verse talks about the transformation. Again, the next two verses, 44, 45, talks about the beauty of the Supreme Lord again. Two more verses again describe the whole beauty of the Supreme Lord, which Kumaras experienced. But before that, there was some transformation in the heart of the four Kumaras. Tasya Ravinda Nayanasya Pada Ravinda Kinjal Kamishra Tulasi Makaranda Vayu Antargata Swavivare Nachakara Tesham Sangshobha Makshara Jusham Apichitta Tanvo.
When the breeze carrying the aroma of tulsi leaves from the toes of the lotus feet of the personality of Godhead entered the nostrils of those sages, they experienced a change both in body and in mind, even though they were attached to the impersonal Brahman understanding.
Having experienced the beautiful form of the Supreme Lord through their eyes, through their nostril, through their tongue, through their ears, through their touch, whatever it is, then now they are going to experience the beauty of the Supreme Lord through their mind. How is that? As the Lord coming very close to the four Kumaras, he has almost reached them. Now, on the way they saw the beauty of the Supreme Lord, now he has reached close to them. So when the Lord is in the vicinity of the four Kumaras, the surrounding cool breezes, which we already discussed, the umbrella is like the moon, and the pulse are like the water drops, and the entire aroma is surrounded by wonderful breezes. And of course, the two people are standing on either side, they are doing a chamar seva. So the air is gently breezing around. That gently breezing air flowing through the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, because the yogis and jnanis, they meditate on the lotus feet of Supreme Lord. So for that reason, the breeze which is flowing through the lotus feet of Supreme Lord, taking the fragrance of the tulsi, which is kept on the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, entered into the nostrils of the four Kumaras. Having entered into the nostrils, it straight away goes to the heart. In the heart, that fragrance enters into the mind, and that mind gets disturbed. Till now, that mind is always thinking about, talking about, meditating upon the Brahman aspect of the Supreme Lord. But now, the personal form of the Supreme Lord entered through the fragrant breeze, touching the tulsi, which is touching the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. In a way, the touch sensation of the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord, carrying through the medium of the air, entered into the heart of the four Kumaras. And that a small bodily limb of the Supreme Lord, the lotus feet, where the space occupied by the tulsi flowers, transformed the art completely. Sangshova Makshara Jusham Apichitta Tanva. Though they were contemplating upon Brahman, they are always thinking about Brahman, meditating on Brahman, but now this fragrance kind of disturbed their mind. And now they are experiencing the bliss of tasting the beautiful form of the Supreme Lord. Sankshobham akshara jusham apichitta tanva antargatena svavirena chakara tesham. So now they are experiencing the bliss of tasting the personal form of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that is kind of sankshobham akshara jusham apichitta tanva, their whole body kind of transformed. It is kind of called as vikara. So that vikara is manifested in the form of the symptoms of bhava. If you remember in NOD, the symptoms of bhava are explained. That hair standing on the end, eyes downpouring the tears, and the person starts crying, etc., etc. All these symptoms manifested for a while in four kumaras. Having had darshan of the Supreme Lord, having tasted the beauty of the Supreme Lord. So that is being indicated in this verse. As soon as they saw the Lord's features, their minds changed. In other words, the impersonalist who feels transcendental pleasure in striving to become one with the Lord is defeated when he sees the beautiful transcendental feature of the Supreme Lord. So in that way. So basically, we always think that, okay, fragrance entered, not like that. The first touch of Lord's personality had entered into the heart of four kumaras. So Lord is in a way directly came in contact with the four kumaras. That is understanding. So now next two verses talks about full beauty of the Supreme Lord once again. Now previously they were witnessing the beauty of the Lord as a general visitor. But now their heart is melted. In that melted condition, now they are witnessing the beauty of the Supreme Lord. The next two verses are describing the beauty witnessed by the four kumaras in their melted condition. Deva amushya vadana sita padma kosham udviksha sundarata sundara taradara kundahasam labdha shisha punaravekshata diyamangri dvandvam nakarunamani shrayanam nidayam nacharanam nidadhyu.
The Lord's beautiful face appeared to them like the inside of a blue lotus, and the Lord's smile appeared to be a blossoming jasmine flower. After seeing the face of the Lord, the sages were fully satisfied, and when they wanted to see him further, they looked upon the nails of his lotus feet, which resembled rubies. Thus, they viewed the Lord's transcendental body again and again, and so they finally achieved meditation on the Lord's personal feature.
So here, one interesting thing is given here. Labdha shisha. So it is mentioned in the purport by Sri Chandra that labdha ashisha. Ashish means ashirvad. So they've already got the ashirvad from Lord Brahma and Narada Muni. Lord Brahma and Narada Muni have told many times to four kumaras about the description of the beautiful form of the Supreme Lord. So kumaras have kind of heard it and have forgot it. Or they have heard it and they did not pay much attention because they were devotees of Brahman. But whatever they have heard through the mouth of Brahma and Narada Muni has become reality now. Labdha shisha. The both Brahma and Narada Muni prayed for this day. They are blessed for this day. They said that one day you will have darshan of the Supreme Lord. Then you see me. It's like that. So now that blessing has become reality today. So by the blessings of Brahma and Narada Muni, now they are experiencing the beauty of the Supreme Lord. So now what they are doing? They are looking feet, abdomen and the face. Again abdomen, feet. Like that they are looking up and down to the entire form of the Supreme Lord. So like that. Again and again, whatever description Narada Muni gave and Brahmaji gave, they are cross-checking and verifying whether everything is there, like that. So that is the understanding. Pumsham gatim mrugayatam iha yoga margair dhyanaspadam bahumatam nayanabhiramam पंष्णम वपुर्दर्शय दर्शयानम अनन्य सिद्धैर औत्पत्तिकै समग्रम युतम अष्टभोगैर.
This is the form of the Lord which is meditated upon by the followers of the yoga process, and it is pleasing to the yogis in meditation. It is not imaginary but factual, as proved by great yogis. The Lord is full in 8 kinds of achievement, but for others these achievements are not possible in full perfection.
So here Prabhupada goes into great detail about a yogi. How they perform yoga, Ashtanga yoga, and the Jnani, how they perform Jnana Marga, etc., etc. So Prabhupada goes into many details. But in summary, one word if you see, Pumsham Gatim Mrugayatam Iha Yoga Margair. The people of this world who generally go from transmigration from one body to other body, they always want to attain moksha through the Yoga Marga. Because moksha generally means, okay, one need to perform Ashtanga yoga and attain yoga moksha. That is what is being talked about. Or some people might say that perform Ashtanga yoga and get Ashtasiddhis, by which you get bliss as much as possible in this material world. That is the purpose of the life. Like that many say. Dhyanaspadam bahumatam nayanabhi ramam. And in that Ashtanga yoga, during the stages of dharana, dhyana, samadhi, though it is not their cherished goal, but they are forced to meditate upon the beautiful form of the Supreme Lord. Whether they want it or not, the yoga practitioner should meditate on Paramatma form in Dhyana, Dharana, Dhyana, Samadhi. And that form of Paramatma is being witnessed by the four Kumaras in front of their eyes. And then, they are not only witnessing, but they are also experiencing the bliss of the personal form of the Supreme Lord. So that is what is indicated here. So what is so great about this personal form of the Supreme Lord? Tamshnam vapur darshayanam ananya siddhir. Darshayanam ananya siddhir. Though the yogis perform yoga in order to get ashtasiddhis, but the Lord's form is ananya siddhi. It is not that easily obtained. It is not so easily obtained. And what kind of form is that? Pamshnam Vapur. That form is similar to that of a human being. So Lord Swami is not something different, not something imaginary, and not something entirely different from those things we have experience of. Not like that. His form is similar to human form, or otherwise, human form is similar to Lord's form, like that. So, but though it is like human form, it is ananya siddhir. It is not that simply it does not come. Ananya siddhi. It is the perfection of those people who perform only bhakti other than anything. Without bhakti, you don't take shelter of karma, jnana, yoga or anything else. Ananya bhakti. Those who perform ananya bhakti. And the perfection of those ananya bhaktas is having the darshan of the beautiful form of the Supreme Lord, which is like the human. So like that. Atpattikai samagram yutam ashtabhogair. And that form is endowed with 8 qualities and experienced by the wonderful devotees. The Supreme Lord possesses 8 wonderful qualities which are experienced by the wonderful devotees of the Supreme Lord. So that is being indicated. Otherwise, for the Ashtanga Yoga practitioners, Ashtabhogai can indicate that they experience the 8 powers of the Supreme Lord in the form of 8 siddhis, Ashtasiddhis. But when it comes to devotees, they actually experience the beauty of the Supreme Lord in his 8 features. Lord's beauty has 8 features. What are the 8 features? The 8 features are in relation to the sound, touch, form, taste, smell. These are the 5 sense objects. We have the 5 Jnanendriyas, they have 5 things to get it. Those things can be obtained by the vision of the Supreme Lord. Fine. The remaining 3 are Lord's mercy, Lord's pastimes, and Lord's strength, Lord's power. So how the devotees experience all these eight qualities, wonderful qualities of the Supreme Personality of Godhead? So it is explained that in the case of yogis, they may experience the eight qualities of the Supreme Lord in the form of eight siddhis. But for devotees, the devotees experience out of eight, the seven items are, when it comes to sound, they will hear the beautiful words of the Supreme Lord that they experience. And then the softness of the Supreme Lord, they experience by the touch of the Supreme Lord. If you remember, if you have heard in the Bhagavatam classes that when Dhruva Maharaj had darshan of the Supreme Lord, Lord Vishnu touched him on the head of Dhruva Maharaj. And when Prahlad Maharaj came near to Lord Narasingadev with a desire to offer prayers, Lord Narasingadev also touched Prahlad Maharaj. So, conch shell hai beech mein, but hand se touch karna wala hai na. That hand is wearing the conch shell. Chanka chakra gada patma. So conch shell is there in between. So in that. So that is, one experience the beauty, softness or tenderness of the Supreme Lord by Lord's touch. And one experience the beautiful form of the Supreme Lord by one's eyes. With eyes, the beautiful form can be experienced. And one experience the taste of the Supreme Lord by tasting the Mahaprasad and Charanamrut of the Supreme Lord. And one experiences the fragrance of the Supreme Lord, the smell of the Supreme Lord, by experiencing the fragrance of the scent that we offer to the Supreme Lord, or the flower garlands after taken out of the Supreme Lord, like that. Sorry. One can experience the fragrance of the Supreme Lord also. Because the flower garland was in touch with the Supreme Lord's body for so long, for the entire day. In the evening when it is taken out, we can smell the fragrance of the flower garlands. In a way, actually, it is the fragrance of the body of the Supreme Lord in that way. And Lord's affection we can experience by Lord's compassion and mercy. Whatever affection Lord has. And his Lord's activities we can experience by hearing his pastimes. And finally, the sixth one, Lord's power can be experienced by experiencing the six qualities of the Supreme Lord, the six qualities of Bhagavan. Aishwaryasya samagrasya, viryasya yashasashriya, jnana vairagyoschaiva sannambhaga itingana. So these six wonderful qualities of the Supreme Lord are his powers. So the devotee experiences all these things like this. Through five senses, devotees experience Lord's beautiful form in different various proportions. And they also experience Lord's mercy through his compassionate dealings with the devotees. And they experience Lord's actions by hearing Lord's pastimes. And they experience Lord's powers by hearing and understanding and witnessing the six opulence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, with which he is called as Bhagavan. So that is the understanding. So the devotees experience the Supreme Lord with his eight qualities. And the yogis who only want to perform yoga, they may experience Lord's powers in the form of eight siddhis. So it is like that. So this is what Prabhupada explains in the entire purport, one by one. Of course, Prabhupada goes into more details about how the jnanis perform their jnana and yogis perform their yoga and devotees perform their bhakti. The similarities and the contrasts are explained by Srila Prabhupada in this purport. So now, having tasted the beauty of the Supreme Lord, now the four Kumaras are going to speak to the Supreme Lord. Any questions till now?
Hare Krishna. Prabhuji, there are some questions from the previous class. Should I ask now or later?
Okay, one question.
Okay. Prabhuji, like in last lecture, you explained that this Vaikuntha description, whatever was going on, that is the immediate Vaikuntha planet, which is, means I didn't get whatever you explained, that whether it is on the borderline of material world and spiritual world or within the material world, something like that it was mentioned.
No, so this I explained long back in a couple of classes before. This is located just above Satyaloka. as you go upward, Bhuloka, Bhuvarloka, Swargaloka, Maharloka, Janaloka, Tapaloka, Satyaloka, then comes Vaikuntha, before the seven layers of the universe. This Vaikuntha is within our universe only. That is so, where the four Kumaras went.
So how to understand this, Prabhuji? Because we say that Vaikuntha is a spiritual planet and...
Okay, wait. I also told that the Manvantara Avatara, who is responsible to look after the activities of a Manvantara, he stays here in this Vaikuntha. In Dhruvaloka, Kshirodaksha Vishnu stays. In Garbhodaka Ocean, Garbhodaksha Vishnu stays. And this Vaikuntha, which is located just above Satyaloka, the Manvantara Avatara stays, who is responsible for the maintenance of the universe during the Manvantara period. For every Manvantara, there is one Manvantara Avatara. For example, right now, currently, in this Vaikuntha, Lord Vamana is there.
Okay.
He is the Manvantara Avatara for the seventh Manu.
Okay, it means what I understood is like Manvantara Avatara will stay in whichever Vaikuntha, that Vaikuntha will be situated within the material realm. Like.
Yes.
Every time means for each Manvantara, there will be different incarnation of the Lord which will be staying in that particular Vaikuntha.
Yes, perfect.
Okay, and there was one more thing you explained, Prabhuji, that Lord incarnated in various species, but in Vaikuntha there is no insects, something like that you explained in the last class.
Yes.
So we also saw that Lord's garland has many humming bees, and their fluttering of their wings is causing the sound of Lord's name. So means how we consider bees as not as a insects there, or how it is?
No, bees are born out of sweat. Those beings which are born out of sweat are not there in Vaikuntha. That description is not there. Like that, Vishnu Chakra says that, seems that these beings are not worshipping the Supreme Lord, so their description is not there. So
these humming bees which are there in Vaikuntha, they are not born out of, they are not Svedaj.
They are not Svedaja. They are, I think, Andaja. They are born out of eggs or something like that.
Okay, fine. Other questions I'll ask later.
Okay. कुमार ऊचु यो अंतरहितो हृदिगतोपि दुरात्मनां त्वं सोद्यैव नो नयनमूलमनन्तराद्धा यर्हेव कर्णविवरेण गुहां गतो न पित्रानुवर्णितरः भवदुद्भवेन.
Our dear Lord, you are not manifested to rascals, even though you are seated within the heart of everyone. But as far as we are concerned, we see you face to face, although you are unlimited. The statements we have heard about you from our father Brahma through the years have now been actually realized by your kind appearance.
So basically, here they say two points that your form cannot be witnessed by sinful people. Dauratmanam they can't see. Dauratma means who are sinful inclined, they cannot see the Lord. Though we have heard from our father long back, though the description have entered our heart long back, but now for the first time, your personal form directly entered into our heart. So today we really became fortunate. So in that way, they are actually expressing their good fortune to Lord Vishnu. Yariheva karna vivarena guham gatona. Though you have entered through our ear holes long back, being spoken by Lord, our father Brahmaji. Pitranu varnita raha bhavaudbhavena. But today you have actually taken place within our heart after having darshan of your beautiful form. So like that, they are actually expressing their gratitude to Supreme Lord. So that is the understanding. So here Prabhupada says that although the Lord is not visible in the beginning because of his glaring bodily effulgence, if a devotee sincerely wants to see him, the Lord is revealed to him. It is said in Bhagavad Gita that the Lord cannot be seen by our imperfect eyes. He cannot be heard by our imperfect ears, and he cannot be experienced by our imperfect senses. But if one engages in devotional service with faith and devotion, then God reveals himself. Naham prakasha sarvasya yogamaya samavruta. Whether it is for sinful people or impersonalists, Lord cannot be revealed immediately. So Lord waits till and tests the eagerness of the devotees. Then he will reveal, he will make himself available to those devotees. So it's like that. So that darshan, which is not so easy, but by the blessings of Narada Muni and by the blessings of Brahma, now the four Kumaras had the good fortune of having darshan of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So they are telling that, though we have heard about you long back, that information is still there within our heart. And don't be angry with us like that. They are kind of expressing their claim. So today we have good fortune of having your darshan. So that's how the four Kumaras kind trying to please the Supreme Personality of Godhead by their pleasing words. So Prabhupada says that just like the four Kumaras have heard about the Supreme Lord from Brahma and also Narada Muni, so all of us also should hear about the Supreme Lord from the acharyas coming in the bona fide disciplic succession. That is the only way to understand about the Supreme Lord. Otherwise, we can never understand about the Supreme Lord like that. Tam tvam vidama bhagavan paramatma tattvam satvena sampratiratim rachayantamesham yattenu tapa viditair drudha bhakti yogair udgrantayo hrudi vidur munayo viraga.
We know that you are the Supreme Absolute Truth, the Personality of Godhead, who manifests his transcendental form in the uncontaminated mode of pure goodness. This transcendental eternal form of your personality can be understood only by your mercy through unflinching devotional service by great sages whose hearts have been purified in the devotional way.
Yeah. Here they express their humility and they express the glory of bhakti. Tam tvam vidama bhagavan paramatma tattvam. Till now, we were only focused on atma tattva. That is about Brahman. We dedicated our time, energy and enthusiasm to understand about atma tattva and to explain about atma tattva to everyone. Here atma means parama, that Brahman. But today, after having witnessed your beautiful form, Bhagavan Paramatma Tattvam, the Bhagavan feature becomes Paramatma Tattvam. The Brahman feature becomes inferior and Bhagavan feature becomes superior. Now today we can understand, though we have heard from Narada Muni and Brahma for many times about the glories of Bhagavan form, but till now we were always thinking that Atma is superior. That means Brahman is superior. But today we can understand the greatness of Bhagavan. And this greatness of Bhagavan cannot be understood on our own. Satvena sampratiratim rachayantamesham. The rati towards Bhagavan feature of the Supreme Lord can be possible only by satvena, by the association of pure devotees of the Supreme Lord. Without the association of pure devotees of the Supreme Lord, one can never develop inclination towards Bhagavan feature of the Supreme Lord. That's why in the next line they say that yatte anutapa viditair drudha bhakti yogair. It is only by practicing drudha bhakti yoga one can be freed from anutapa and one can become drenched in the bliss of experiencing the transcendental form of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Udgrantayo hrudi vidur munayo viraga. Otherwise the munis like us, whose heart is udgrantayo, means who is completely detached from this material world, with everything that of this material world, are only attached to Brahman. It is very difficult for such kind of people without performing bhakti to experience or to understand your personal feature, to your transcendental form of this Bhagavan. So they indicate that It is only by the mercy of pure devotees like Narada and Brahma, it is only by experience, practicing Drudha Bhakti Yoga, one cannot understand about your personal form, one cannot experience the bliss of your Bhagavan feature. Otherwise, they will only think that Brahman feature is the supreme or best, like us, the way we are thinking till now. So like that. So here they are expressing their humility to the Supreme Lord. So Prabhupada also says same thing. This mercy can be pursued by the devotee when he is completely freed from the contamination. It is stated therefore that only when all contamination is rooted out and the devotee is completely detached from the material attractions, he can receive this mercy of the Supreme Lord. So this is the explanation of the word, last word, viraga. A devotee should become detached for material enjoyment or the material attractions. Then a person will become qualified to experience the bliss of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Of course, on one side, one should become detached from the material allurements. On the other side, one should not be too much attached to Brahman also. If one is too much attached to Brahman, then there is a tendency that, okay, they may look at Bhagavan feature as the inferior. So that is also there. So there should be a balance between those two. And then, by the mercy of the devotees, one can experience the bliss of Bhagavan form. And they further continue in the next two couple of verses. Natyantikam viganayanti apite prasadam kim vanyadarpita bayam bruva unnayaste yeyangatvadangri sharana bhavata kataya kirtanya tirtha yashasa kushala rasagna.
Persons who are very expert and most intelligent in understanding things, as they are engaged in hearing narrations of the auspicious activities and pastimes of the Lord, which are worth chanting and worth hearing, such persons do not care even for the highest material benediction, namely liberation, to say nothing of other less important benedictions like the material happiness of the heavenly kingdom.
So here again they give comparison to devotees and the jnanis and yogis, the Brahman worshippers. Na atyantikam viganayanti apite prasadam. So they say that one does not say that if they become attracted to Brahman, that is your mercy. The people who become attracted to Brahman, They are not actually the true recipient of your mercy. Only those people who become attracted to your Bhagavan feature only are the true recipient of your mercy. So like that. Na atyantikam viganayanti. It is not your highest mercy upon those who become attracted to Brahman or become attracted to liberation. Kimbu anyad arpita bayam. Then what to speak of other positions? Like people becoming attracted to becoming Indra, Varuna, Vayu, even up to the position of Brahma, who are subjected to the fear of time. Every personality has the fear of time because time destroys their lifespan. Superior to that is Brahman. So is attaining a position as Supreme Devata in this material world or attaining position in Brahman is not your true mercy. But what is the true mercy of the Supreme Lord? Ye anga tvadangri sharana. Your mercy is shown upon your anga. Anga means your own devotees. Who are the devotees? Tvadangri sharana. Who have taken shelter upon your lotus feet. Bhavata katayam. What they will do after taking shelter of your lotus feet? They continuously hear your wonderful pastimes. Bhavata katayam. They discuss or hear. Why? For what purpose? Kirtanya tirtha yashasa kushala rasagna. They are the knowers of tasting rasa, the bliss of Bhagavan. What kind of bliss they have? By discussing Krishna Katha, by hearing Krishna Katha, they actually experience your personality in that process of Kirtana and Shravana, Shravana and Kirtana. Because Kirtanya Tirtha Yashasa. The description, the Krishna Katha, wherein the yashas, the wonderful glories of your personality are being sung in that Krishna Katha, in that Vaishnava Sangha. So there, by hearing about your wonderful qualities, form and attributes and name, the devotees truly experience the superior degree of bliss in comparison to the bliss of attaining the position of Brahma or Shiva, or not Shiva, Brahma or Indra, etc., some devata in this material world, are attaining the position in Brahman. So now they are kind of glorifying the position of devotees in this verse.
O Lord, we pray that you let us be born in any hellish condition of life, just as long as our hearts and minds are always engaged in the service of your lotus feet. Our words are made beautiful by speaking of your activities, just as tulsi leaves are beautified when offered unto your lotus feet. And as long as our ears are always filled with the chanting of your transcendental qualities.
So here in this verse, they are expressing their prayer to Lord Vishnu. So Lord Vishnu might ask, oh, what exactly you want? You are glorifying the devotees so much. Okay, fine. You want something? So what they want now, they are expressing in this verse. They say that, Kamam Bhava, that is our desire. Swavrijinaya Nireyeshu Nastas. We are not mind. We don't mind even if we were sent to hell for our sinful activity of cursing your two associates, Jaya and Vijaya. But though we may go to hell, but we want this one thing. Cheto alivad yedunute padayo rameta. Just like alivad, the bumblebee, which is always hovering around you, or the flower garland decorating your neck. Similarly, let our consciousness always hover around your two lotus feet. Even though for our sinful activity, we may have to go to hell, no problem, we'll go. We accept we made a mistake, but let our consciousness always hover around your beautiful lotus feet. Padayo Rameta. Let it have an attraction towards your lotus feet. Why lotus feet? The bumblebees, generally they enter into a lotus flower or any other flowers, which also have some thorns in between. The stem of the lotus will have too many thorns. So passing through all these thorns on the stem, the bumblebee enters into the lotus flower where it can experience the nectar. Similarly, we are ready to go through the thorny like nectar and hell, but let our consciousness be at your lotus feet, experiencing nectar of your lotus feet. And then that is about our consciousness. Cheto, then vachas chana tulasivad edite angri shobha. The tulasi becomes decorated beautiful only when it is kept at the lotus feet of Supreme Lord. Similarly, let our words become glorious by glorifying your wonderful activities. So it is like that. Puryedate guna ganair yadikarna randra. So here they say that let our ears always filled with hearing your wonderful qualities. So like that. So these are the three desires they are expressing to Supreme Lord. So they say that Kamam Bhava, this is their desire. They say that though we may go to hell, no problem. Hell is like the thorny bushes. But let our consciousness be attracted to your lotus feet. And our words, let always talk about your wonderful lotus feet, your wonderful pastimes. and let our ear holes. The ear holes are filled with ether, the space. The space is unlimited. So there is unlimited space for your pastimes to be heard. So let us always continue to spend our time in hearing your wonderful pastimes. So they are kind of best out of the bad bargain. Because they have come to Vaikuntha, they have darshan of the Supreme Lord. They are requesting from the Supreme Lord the best thing one can request. You remember what was the prayer offered by Parikshit Maharaj at the end of the first canto, 19th chapter? Parikshit Maharaj also somewhat offered a prayer similar to this. Sanskrit shloka.
Before Bhagavatam, I have never studied Sanskrit.
Anyone remember what was the shloka? In the first canto, are the three desires expressed by Parikshit Maharaj? Ratita, Adhishneshu, or Punascha Bhuyad. That was the verse. Prati Prasangacha Tadashrayeshu. That was one thing. So let me have the friendly dealings with your devotees. And let me have compassion to all the living entities. And let me have devotion unto you. So that was the desire expressed by Parikshit Maharaj. So one should aspire to have that kind of desire. That is what is expected. Punascha bhuyat bhagavati anante prati prasanga cha tadashrayeju. What was the next line? Mastu yamyam upayami srishtim maitra su sarvatra namo dvijebhya. Even though if I have to take birth again and again in this world because of my karma, maitrastu sarvatra namo dvijebhya. Let me have friendly disposition towards all the living entities. And rati towards your lotus feet, your Krishna Katha. And association of your wonderful devotees. So that was the desire asked by Prahlad Maharaj. Similarly, Parikshit Maharaj. Here the four Kumaras also asking for similar desire. Even in the fourth canto, we'll read that Dhruva Maharaj, Prithu Maharaj, Pratyatas will also ask similar desire. They want to have the association of devotees so that they can hear about the Supreme Lord unlimitedly. Before going to Vaikuntha, they want to do some spiritual sense gratification here, hearing Krishna Katha. So now Kumaras kind of concluding. Pradushchakartayadidam puruhutarupam teneshaner ritim avapuralam drushona tasmaidam bhagavate namayid videma yonatmanam do yonatmanam durudayo bhagavan pratita.
O Lord, we therefore offer our respectful obeisances unto your eternal form as the personality of Godhead, which you have so kindly manifested before us. Your supreme eternal form cannot be seen by unfortunate, less intelligent persons, but we are so much satisfied in our mind and vision to see it.
So it is said that the unfortunate people, it is very difficult for them to have the darshan of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But somehow or other, by the blessings of Narada Muni, and Brahma, we had the darshan of your lotus feet. And by your mercy, we tasted the bliss of Bhagavan's feature. So that is the understanding. It is only by your mercy, we have really experienced your wonderful form today. So that is what they are indicating. So they are expressing their gratitude to Supreme Lord for because though in spite of being they are yogis and jnanis, they experienced the Bhagavan feature of the Supreme Personality of Godhead today. So expressing this, having offered their obeisance at the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the four Kumaras became silent. And that is being further carried on. The discussion, okay, that, then what happened? That will be said by Brahma. Brahma vacha iti tad gruna tamtesham muninam yoga dharminam prati nandya jagadedam vaikunta nilayo vidu.
Lord Brahma said, after this congratulating the sages for their nice work, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, whose abode is in the kingdom of God, spoke as follows.
Being pleased with the glorification of the Kumaras, the Lord began to speak. The Supreme Lord speaks for 11 verses, 2 to 11. So the Lord speaks in a pleasing manner that the Kumaras should not feel that they are disrespected or they are neglected or they are ill-treated, even though they have cursed the two wonderful associates of the Supreme Lord, Jaya and Vijaya, still Lord speaks to them very gently. And in these verses, actually he expresses the behavior of a person, what kind of behavior a person should be having towards a Brahmana. So that is being indicated in these next verses. Sri Bhagavan Vacha Etau Tau Parshadau Mayam Jayo Vijaya Evacha Kadarti Krityamam Yadvo Bau Akratam Atikramam.
Personality for God had said, these attendants of mine, Joy and Vijay by name, have committed a great offense against you because of ignoring me.
So it's like that. So Lord accepts that Jaya and Vijaya had committed a great offense against you, both you, four personalities. So like that. This is happened because they have ignored me. Because I always show great regard to the Brahmanas, great respect to Brahmanas. By disrespecting you, by showing disrespect to four of you, the Jaya and Vijaya have ignored me. They have ignored my order. They have ignored my intentions, etc. Yeah, they should have allowed. But somehow or other, they did not allow. That indicates, the Lord says that they ignored my personality. So it is like that. Prabhupada writes, to commit an offense at the feet of a devotee of the Lord is a great wrong. Even when a living entity is promoted to Vaikuntha, there is still the chance that he may commit offenses. But the difference is that when one is in a Vaikuntha planet, even if by chance one commits an offense, he is protected by the Lord. This is the remarkable fact in the dealings of the Lord and the servitor, as seen in the present incident concerning Jaya and Vijaya. The word atikramam used here indicates that in offending a devotee, one neglects the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So by offending four Kumaras, Jaya Vijaya ignored the Supreme Lord. But the Supreme Lord, even though in spite of making mistake even in Vaikuntha, the Supreme Lord still show his compassion upon his devotees. So that is the theme of this section. Of course, Prabhupada goes into more details about Chota Haridas, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's dealings, and Haridas Tagore, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's dealings. So I have some details from Chaitanya Charitamrita. So, etc. So now, the future words of the Supreme Lord are like, whether Lord is really glorifying the Brahmanas and glorifying Kumaras or criticizing, very difficult to understand, equivocal words. He speaks in such a wonderful manner, the four Kumaras become speechless. Even they cannot understand also what exactly Lord was intending on to the four Kumaras. So like that he speaks. Esvetayor druto dando bhavad birma manuvratair sayevanumato smabir munayo devahelanat.
O great sages, I approve of the punishment that you who are devoted to me have meted out to them.
So basically, whatever punishment you have accorded on the Kumaras, I do accept that. So by stopping you, the four Kumaras, the Jaya Vijaya kind of disrespected my order. They have ignored me. So whatever punishment you award, I will accept it. I am with you. So in a way, so by not expressing any displeasure with four Kumaras, Lord says that I am with you. Whatever you have done is perfect light. So that four Kumaras should feel comfortable. So this is like treating a guest. When a guest comes home, one should treat nicely. So in that way. That can be seen in the case of Bhrugumuni entering into Vaikuntha and kicking on chest of Lord Vishnu. In spite of being kicked by Bhrugumuni, Lord Vishnu invites him, makes him sit on his own bed and washes his feet and massages his feet like that. That is the way the Supreme Lord reacts with the Brahmanas. So like that. Tadva prasadayami adya brahma daivam param hime taddi atmakrutam manye yasvapum virasatkrutam.
To me, the Brahmana is the highest and the most beloved personality. The disrespect shown by my attendants has actually been displayed by me because the domain are my servitors. I take this to be an offense by myself. Therefore, I seek your forgiveness for the incident that has arisen.
So here Lord says that I consider the Brahmanas to be the top. Brahma Devam Param Himay. For me, the Brahmanas are the topmost worshipable object. And the Jaya Vijaya are my servants. And Jaya Vijaya offended you four Brahmanas. That is as good as my offense. Because the master is responsible for the activities of the servants. Taddi Atma Krutam Manne. I consider that I have by personally offended you. Yeswa Bumbir Asat Kuma Asat Krutam. For this Asat Krita, for this offensive activity, but actually by disrespecting you, by stopping your entry into Vaikuntha, I have performed Asat Krita. I have performed a sinful act. I have confirmed an offense against you. So like that Lord says. So Lord accepts the offense of his servants as his own offense. Yes, Prabhu. Go Brahmana Itayacha. So Brahmana's life is all about describing the glories of the Supreme Lord. Yeah. True Brahmana. Not just Brahmana by birth, but the true activity of Brahmana. Of course, we will discuss in one of the future verses. Here, Lord Vishnu is, in a way, speaking sarcastically also. Not just a Brahmana. If one is a Brahmana devotee, all these words are applicable. Not just for a Brahmana. Not for simple, ordinary Brahmana. If one is a devotee and a Brahmana, all these words are applicable. If simply a Brahmana, but not a Vaishnava, not a devotee, then no need to worry about so much in that sense. Because a Brahmana devotee dedicated one's life for the service of the Supreme Lord. That kind of person, Lord is saying that, worshipable. A just Brahmana who is only interested in performing some rituals and earning dakshina and for his own livelihood. Okay. So in that way. Even in fact, Lord goes into one step ahead in the next verse. He says that whatever offense committed by my assistants is my offense against you. I consider that I personally committed offense against you. So in that way. Of course, Prabhupada goes into the same thing what we are discussing, the Brahmana and Vaishnava. Because the Supreme Lord is Go Brahmana Itayacha, he always shows great respect towards the Brahmanas. But if that Brahmana is a Vaishnava, whatever word spoken by the Lord is applicable to that kind of a Brahmana Vaishnava devotee. So in that way. Yannamani cha grihnanti loko brutye kritagasi so saduvadas tat kirtim हन्ति त्वचम् इवा मया
A wrong act committed by a servant leads people in general to blame his master, just as a spot of white leprosy on any part of the body pollutes all of the skin.
So just like a person whose body the complexion is full white, if there is a white mark on that, so fully clear, if there is a white mark, people start criticizing that person, hey, leprosy aa gaya. Similarly, whatever a mistake made by the servant is a white spot or a black mark on the master. So like that Lord is saying that. So whatever mistake committed by my servant is my mistake only, because I accepted him as my servant, so I accept their mistake as my mistake. So like that the Supreme Lord is actually owning the Jaya Vijaya. So in a way, on the other side, though in one side is glorifying the Brahmanas, on the other side is also taking care of his two assistants, Jaya and Vijaya. He is not disowning the Jaya and Vijaya. So I accept them, they made a mistake, I accept as my mistake. Like that, Lord is showing his compassion towards Jaya and Vijaya. So here, Prabhupada writes, a devotee should always see that his Vaishnava qualities increase with the advancement of his Krishna consciousness. A devotee should be blameless, because any offense by the devotee is a scar on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When we go into society, we do some wrong thing, and they will say, these Krishna Bhaktas are all like this only. Lord Krishna is at blame. Even if one devotee does something mistake, something terrible, the Krishna becomes blamed like that. The devotee's duty is to be always conscious in his dealings with others, especially with another devotee of the Supreme Lord. So when the dealings go wrong with respect to devotee, that becomes vice, offense. So in the society in general, the Lord is blamed for that. So in that way, one should be careful in one dealing, when one's dealings, because we are representing the Supreme Lord. So like that. So it will be a black spot on the Supreme Lord, as Lord says here. यस्यामृतामलयश श्रवणावगान सद्य पुनाति जगद जगदश्वपशाजिमु विकुंठ सोहं भवद्य उपलब्ध श्रुति सुतीर कीर्ति चिंद्यं स्वबाहुमपि वा प्रतिकूल वृत्तिम
एनीवन इन द एंटायर वर्ल्ड even down to the chandala who lives by cooking and eating flesh of the dog is immediately purified if he takes bath in hearing through the ear the glorification of my name, fame, etc. Now you have realized me without doubt. Therefore, I will not hesitate to lop off my own arm if its conduct is found hostile to you.
So here the Lord says that. So Lord glorifies himself in one sense. Yasya amruta amala yasha shravanava gada sadhya punanti jagada jagadashva pachad vikunta. Even the swapacha, the dog eater, can become cleansed immediately and completely purified by hearing my glories. How? Through the mouth of the Brahmanas, when they describe. As the Brahmanas, the life's mission is to describe the beautiful, wonderful qualities of the Supreme Lord. Hearing the Brahmanas, the Swapacha, the dog eater, and all other people of this world can sadhya punanti. Immediately they become cleansed. And that is the service rendered by the Brahmanas. And how can I show disrespect to those Brahmanas? So hum bhavadaya upalabdha su tirtha kirtis. You Brahmanas make me at the su tirtha kirti. You, by describing my wonderful qualities and activities and other things, you make me at the most qualified holy place to be visited. And chindyam swabahum apiva pratikula vrittim. If somebody disrespects you I'll cut off my own bodily limbs. And here, especially here in this case, the Jaya and Vijaya are like my two hands. They are my gatekeepers. They are disrespecting you. It is as good as me disrespecting you. I'll cut off my hands for you, Brahmanas. And Acharyas explained that if the Brahmanas are Vaishnava Brahmanas, if their life's mission is to glorify the Supreme Lord, then all the statements made by the Lord is applicable. And on the other side, if you see, the Lord is considering Jaya and Vijaya to be his own two hands. But the Lord is considering them to be very close personalities. So in a way, he is showing his affection towards Jaya and Vijaya also. He is not disowning them. So in that. So indirectly, if you see for the dialogue sake, are you that kind of Brahmanas whose life's mission is the glorifying my wonderful qualities and activities? If you are so, I am sorry for criticism and I am ready to cut off my two hands because Jaya Vijaya committed offense against you. Otherwise, it is not so serious mistake. Don't worry so much like that. Indirectly, Lord is telling. Kumaras can't understand what is the Lord is hinting. Lord is speaking something, is glorifying the Brahmanas like anything. That's what they are hearing. But whether Lord is having something else in his heart and something else, it's like equivocal words. He's saying something like this. If you are that kind of Brahmanas whose life is dedicated to glorify the Lord's qualities, then the statements are right. The Brahmanas are superior, supremely worshipable personalities in that way. So if you remember, any devotees have heard today morning Bhagavatam class? The second verse. What was the second verse? The fourth line. The fourth line of the verse. Dharma projita kaitavotra paramo nirmastaranam satam vedyam vastava matra vastu shivadam tapatrayon mulanam Srimad Bhagavate Mahamunikrute Kimba Parayarishware Sadhyo Prudhi Avarudyate Atrakritibhi Sushrushibhi Tatkshanat. If the devotees have eagerness or inclination to hear about the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sadhyo, immediately, Prudhi Avarudyate, the heart becomes completely cleansed. Sushrushibhi Tatkshanat. Even starts desiring to hear about the Supreme Lord, even starts hearing about the Supreme Lord, the heart immediately becomes cleansed. So that is the glory of hearing about Krishna. That is possible only through the mouth of Brahmanas. If that kind of Brahmanas are offended by my men, I will cut off my two hands like that. So here my men means my other devotees. So one should be careful that devotee should never criticize another devotee. One devotee is discussing the Supreme Lord, dedicated to describe the Supreme Lord, other devotee is criticizing them. The Lord considers that to be I myself criticizing one of my devotee, and I am ready to cut off my limbs. So in that way. So then further continues. The Lord here further says that I develop this quality of purifying even a Swapacha who hears about me, and my lotus feet becomes that glorious because on my head I keep the dust of that kind of Vaishnava Brahmanas who are dedicated to worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead always. It's like that he says in the next verse. Madhav, Lord is speaking false. He is speaking in an equivocal word. What he is saying is actually true in the sense that he will treat like that his devotees. That is the point. He is telling like that. Here, Binit Prabhu says that how can one purify the Lord by keeping the dust on his head? So let us see what were the verse saying. Yes, sevaya charana padma pavitra renum sadyakshata kilamalam pratilabdha shilam nashreer viraktam apimam vijahati yasya preksha lavarta itare niyaman vahanti.
The Lord continued, because I am the servitor of my devotees, my lotus feet have become so sacred that they immediately wipe out all sin. And I have acquired such a disposition that the goddess of fortune does not leave me, even though I have no attachment for her, and others praise her beauty and observe sacred vows to secure from her even a slight favor.
So here says that even Mother Lakshmi does not want to stay apart from my lotus feet. Yes, Sevaya Charanapadna Pavitra Renum Sadhyakshata Kila Malam Pratilabdha Shiram. So why? Service to those lotus feet purifies the entire universe, the entire world, and the people of this world. Everyone gets purified. So, but those feet become purified by service to people like you. Yes, Sevaya. By serving whom? Charanapadna Pavitra Renum. The dust upon my lotus feet becomes purified and becomes qualified to purify the entire universe only by service to Brahmanas like you. In the bracket, the pure Vaishnava Brahmanas. Who? No, don't get into all the details. Four Kumaras are pure Brahmanas only. They are also Vaishnava devotees. But here, this current situation is not so that way. But Lord is, in a way, is not happy with the four Kumaras. You have come to Vaikuntha. Till now, you are hearing Brahman, Brahman, Brahman. You came to Vaikuntha and instead of having darshan of me and you start fighting with Jaya Vijaya. What is this? Yeah. Of course, Jaya Vijaya also made a mistake. That is there. And Kumaras also made a mistake. But in general, here Lord is expressing his concern or his affection toward the Brahmanas who have dedicated their life for the service of the Supreme Lord. That's why Lord has said that go Brahmana Hitayacha, the well-wisher of the cows and the Brahmanas. So we can understand from these verses that nature of that behavior of the Supreme Lord. No, without cow, what Brahmanas will do? Brahmanas can't do anything, na? The cow is the most important thing in the performance of yajna. Cow gives milk. Without milk, there is no curd. Without curd, there is no dahi. There is no ghee. Without ghee, there is no yajna. Obviously, cow ghee only used for yajna. The Brahmana's whole life is centered about yajna, performance of yajna. Or any other activity also centered around cow milk and ghee. Vedic understanding. It is like that. That's why the Supreme Lord is very much. And cow milk is very essential for every human being to sustain this world. The Lord shows his affection through cow milk also. In that way. The actual situation is very bad, but generally. So it is like that. Na Shreer Viraktam Apimam Vijahati Yasya. Even Mother Lakshmi does not want to stay away from our service to my lotus feet. But that lotus feet becomes glorified or becomes powerful by service to Brahmanas like you. So it's like that. And the next verse also, he continues more and more about the Brahmanas.
Naham tatami yajamana havir vitane shochad bruta plutam adan उतबून मुखेना यद् ब्राह्मणस्य मुखतश्चरतो नुघासं तुष्टस्य मै अवहितैर् निजकर्मपाकैर्
I do not enjoy the oblations offered by the sacrifices in the sacrificial fire which is one of my own mouths with the same relish as I do the delicacies overflowing with ghee which are offered to the mouths of Brahmanas who have dedicated to me the results of their activities and who are ever satisfied with my prasad.
Here one simple thing he says that the general procedure of offering oblation to Supreme Lord is through fire sacrifice. In the fire sacrifice they say that either idam Vishnaya Nama, idam Nama, idam like the Lord Vishnu's different names. So idam Rishikeshaya Namaha, idam Namaha, idam Narasimhaya Namaha, idam Namaha, like that. So the Supreme Lord is fed through the fire because fire is the mouth of the Supreme Lord. In the universal form also we saw that from the mouth of the universal form appeared fire. So it is the mouth of the Supreme Lord. Through fire, Lord accepts. But he says that, I am not that much pleased by eating through fire. As much as feeding a Brahmana, the delicacy is filled with ghee. Because in the fire, one offers all the grains along with the ghee. So here his Lord says that, cook all the grains with ghee and feed a Brahmana. When a Brahmana eats those things, eatables and becomes satisfied, I am doubly satisfied. Instead of offering all the ghee and grains in the fire. But in the bracket, one should understand that that Brahmana Vaishnava devotee should be that kind of devotee who is always glorifying about the Supreme Lord, not criticizing the other devotees. Then these statements are valid. Not simply a Brahmana, but the Brahmana should be a Vaishnava Brahmana and always glorifying the Supreme Personality of Godhead. If that kind of Vaishnava Brahmana is fed with the preparations made by Lord Ghee, and if the devotee is satisfied, I am satisfied. So, indirectly, if you remember that verse, Lord Krishna speaks to Arjuna that I don't consider if someone says that they are my devotee, but if someone says that I am the devotee of my devotee, I am happy. So, like that. So, indirectly, is that my devotee should feed other devotees. That will give me satisfaction. So, like that. That is called Nija Karma Paka. Paka means one, this Paka Shastra is cooking. That is Nija Karma Paka. The real way of cooking is feeding the devotees. So, in the way. Prabhupada talks about what is his name? Advaitacharya feeding Haridas Thakur, offering him a first Shadrapata. So it is like that. Because he is a wonderful devotee. Esham bibarmi aham makanda vikunta yoga maya vibhuti ramalangri rajak kiritae vipramtu kona visha visaheta yadar hanamba sadhya punati sa chandra lalama lokan.
I am the master of my unobstructed internal energy, and the water of the Ganges is the remnant left after my feet are washed. That water sanctifies the three worlds along with Lord Shiva, who bears it on his head. If I can take the dust of the feet of the Vaishnava on my head, who will refuse to do the same?
Here the Lord says that, so that kind of Brahmana, if the Brahmana happens to speak something harshly, one should tolerate. One should never disrespect or criticize a Brahmana for their apparent misconduct. Because generally that in this world, the Ganga, which is considered to be Charanamrut of the Lord's lotus feet, Lord Shiva keeps it on his head for his own purification. The entire world wants to take bath in the Ganga so that they want to be purified. And that Ganga, which is emitting from my lotus feet, has that power because I keep the dust on my head, the dust of the lotus feet of those devotees, the Brahmanas, on my head. So I keep the dust of the Brahmanas on my head because of which my feet becomes powerful, by which the water emitting from my feet, Ganga, became so powerful, by which Lord Shiva want to be purified and all the people of this world also want to be purified. So that kind of glory is telling that. So Lord is glorifying the Brahmanas to this extent. So one should take the foot water of he who puts Brahmanas dust on his head. This is one point. So if your devotee puts the dust of another devotee's feet on their head, and this devotee becomes glorious, and that devotee's foot water should be accepted on our head. So indirectly, Lord Vishnu keeps the dust of the devotees on his head. So his feet became powerful. The water washing his feet becomes the holy Tirtha Ganga. That should be accepted by all of us. So something like that. To that effect, it is being indicated. So that means, A devotee should always be worshipable. Even though their conduct may be inappropriate, but they should be always worshipable. They should not be criticized in that way. येमे तनुर्द्विजवरा दुहितेर मदीया भूया नलब्ध शरणानि च भेद बुद्ध्या द्रक्षन्ति अगक्षत दृशो हि अहिमा अहिमन्यवस्तान गृद्रारुषममा कुशन्ति अभिदण्डनेतो.
By their own sin, look upon this as a distinct from me. They are just like a furious serpent.
Those whose faculty of judgment has been impaired by their own sin, look upon this as distinct from me. They are just like furious serpents, and they are angrily torn apart by the bills of the vulture-like messengers of Yamraja, the superintendent of sinful persons.
So here Lord says that, if someone distinguishes me and the Brahmanas as separate entities, they will be punished by Yamaraj or the servants of Yamaraj. They will be taken to hell. So basically he's saying that my devotee Brahmana should never be criticized. If somebody commits an offense against my devotee Brahmanas, they will be taken to hell. Or indirectly, our Lord is speaking to Four Kumara that Brahmanas are so glorified, somebody criticizes them. Just like Jaya Vijaya criticized you. So they are fit to go to hell. So like that he's telling. So sorry, I'm quickly going. Already it is almost 8 o'clock. I'll just briefly touch upon the next two verses. We'll discuss them again in the next class. But because the Lord is speaking, we'll just conclude this two verses. Ye brahmanan mai diyo kshipato archayantas tushya drudasmita sudokshita padma vaktra वाण्यानुराग कलयात्मजयत् गृणाता गृणन्ता संबोधयन्ति अहमिवा इवाहम् उपहारस्तै उपहृतस्तै.
On the other hand, they captivate my heart who are gladdened in heart and who their lotus faces enlightened by nectarian smiles respect the brahmanas even though the brahmanas utter harsh words. They look upon the Brahmanas as my own self and pacify them by praising them in loving words, even as a son would appease an angry father, or as I am pacifying you.
Mm. So here basically Lord says that even if Brahmanas show some misconduct in their behavior, one should never find fault with them, one should never criticize them. Instead, pacify them with kind words, glorify them with praising words, just the way I am treating you. Basically, it's telling that you Brahmanas, you four Kumaras have criticized my devotee, or cursed my devotee. How I am responding to you? By glorifying you. By glorifying all the Brahmanas, glorifying you four. Ye Brahmanan mai diya kshipato archayantas. Actually, it says that I am actually completely controlled by the worship of the Brahmanas. And Tushyad Drida Smita Sudokshita Padma Vaktra. So he says that one should always be pleased with the audience of a Brahmana. One should never behave in a disrespectful way. Even though if those Brahmanas appears to be speaking ill about somebody else, it is up to the Brahmanas. It is Brahmanas' business. I have nothing to do. For me, you are a Brahmana, I always glorify you. Whatever you do, it does not matter. Even if they speak wrongly about somebody else, even if they offend others, even if they criticize others, I always worship the Brahmanas. Because one should see the Brahmanas non-different from the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Ye Brahmanas mai diya. One should always see the Brahmanas as me, as myself, non-different from me. In that way. Va anya anuraga kalaya atmaja vat grinata. It says that one should remain pleased in heart in spite of the harsh words spoken by those Brahmanas. Even though if the Brahmanas scold us, one should say that, my dear Brahmana, you are so merciful upon me, you are actually not scolding me. you are not please speaking very harshly with me. You are actually very merciful to me. Like that, one should reply to those brahmanas. So like that, it says that. And sambodhayanti aham ivaham upahrutaste. It says that even though if the brahmanas criticize cold others, one should speak to them like a son speaks to an angry father in order to pacify the angry father. Or just the way I am speaking to you. You are in anger mode now, but I am speaking to you in a pleasing way to pacify you. Like that, my devotee should treat the brahmanas. Or my devotee should treat other devotees. So like that. So Lord is teaching all of us, making four Kumaras and Jaya Vijaya the Vaya medium.
Prabhuji, this should... is for all Brahmanas, na? Like not only for Vaishnava Brahmanas. Even though Brahmanas are Brahmavadi, still they have to be respected in the same way as Vaishnava Brahmanas.
Yes, yes. Actually, in one sense, Lord is speaking for generally for all Brahmanas, it should be applicable. But Acharyas explained that Lord is actually speaking in an equivocal way. He's speaking something, he's hinting at something else. If they are actually Vaishnava Brahmanas, all these words of the Supreme Lord are holds good. So like that. So basically, they are actually making us that one should be careful dealing with other devotees. While dealing with other devotees.
But here, Lord is speaking, even though these Brahmanas were Brahmavadis, still they have to be respected.
Yes. All the Brahmanas should be respected. But we should be careful while respecting even Vaishnava Brahmanas. Even in that respect, there could be some mistake. So the last verse for today, sorry, already we are late. Tanme svabhartur avasayam alakshamanav yushmad vetikramagatim pratipadya sadhya bhuyo mamantikam itam tadanugrahome yatkalpatamachirato Brutayor Vivasa.
These servants of mine have transgressed against you, not knowing the mind of their master. I shall therefore deem it a favor done to me if you order that, although reaping the fruit of their transgression, they may return to my presence soon and the time of their exile from my abode may expire before long.
Yeah. So on one side, glorifying the Brahmanas and glorifying the four Kumaras, Lord said that according to your utterances, let they go to the place where whatever is suitable for them, for their mistake as a punishment. I do accept, I am with you. I accept everything. But this is my request unto you, Brahmanas, that let they come back to me quickly. Having gone there, having fulfilled whatever reaction they are supposed to go through, let they come back to me. Sadhya, bhuyo. Sadhya means quickly. Bhuyo again. Mamantikam, let they come to me. Eetam, tad anugruhome, by my mercy. So, Lord is speaking in a equivocal way. If Lord is supposed to support four Kumaras, he should have said that, okay, let they go and be punished for a long time. Because they have offended you, Brahmanas, whose life's goal is to glorify me. According to the previous verses. It should have been like that. But Lord is saying that, okay, no problem. According to your word, let they go and be, let they go through the punishment, but let they come back to me quickly. So indirectly, Acharya said that the Lord is showing more affection toward Jaya Vijaya than to four Kumaras. So this is indirectly being indicated through the purports of the Acharyas. So Lord shows his affection to his devotees even if they make a mistake. So devotees should have this faith upon the Supreme Lord. Lord always gives us his compassionate punishment. So in that way. So this is what my understanding. Hare Krishna. We'll stop here. I think Maharaj class might start anytime. So devotees can continue with that. हरे कृष्ण ग्रंथराज श्रीमद् भागवतम की जय श्री प्रभुपाद की जय अनंत कोटि वैष्णव भक्त वृंद की जय
हरे कृष्ण